My name is Ruby Ibarra. I'm a rapper, spoken word artist, and music producer from the Bay Area, California. From the TFCU Talk today, I hope that people feel inspired. I hope that people feel empowered and just feel like, you know, they have a voice to share what they love doing. So you don't necessarily have to be an artist or a poet like me, but to be able to use your platform and to be able to inspire your audience and speak your truth is what I hope that people get from today's talk.
Check, check, check. Yo, Toronto! How are you guys today? You guys feeling empowered so far? You guys feeling inspired? So I just want to, again, give a quick shout out and congratulations to Louisa, who is out here before me. You know, she was talking about being out of your comfort zone. I really needed to hear that personally. This is my first time doing a talk like this. So this is definitely me going out of my comfort zone. But hopefully that you guys will be able to gain something from this talk today. I'm here trying to be inspired by all the amazing people on the panel today as well. So the most important thing that we own and that we can have for ourselves is our identity. You know, our identity, it's our self-worth. It's how we perceive ourselves. It's how we present ourselves to the world as well. It's how we reauthor our past and how we claim and define our present. So what makes up your identity? Anyone care to let me know what makes up your identity? Your actions, your experiences, your beliefs, your faith, ideology, your language, your family, your history, your past, all those things, right? So my family and I, we came out to the United States from the Philippines when I was a little girl. I remember the experience, I felt like I was just thrown into water. I felt like I had no idea what was this new culture around me, this new language, all these new sea of faces that I have never seen before. And I remember at the time, I couldn't realize it, but I can only imagine now that, you know, from my parents' point of view, that experience from going from one country to another must have felt completely, drastically different from my experience, you know, as first generation Filipino Americans. And a lot of my experiences when I first migrated to the US were, a lot of questions popped up in my head. Like, who is allowed to speak? Who is allowed to have a voice? Whose voice do we deem as a neutral perspective? Whose stories do we consider worth sharing? Growing up Filipino American, it was, I think, early on implanted in my head that, you know, a lot of the stories, you know, that I read in the books that I read growing up, a lot of the stories that I would see in a lot of the movies that I would watch growing up were told from, you know, a certain perspective. It was never really reflective of my experiences or my family's experiences. I think I never, you know, saw the people that look like me being portrayed in movies and in the books that I read. And I think that, so having seen this, I had the belief that these were the voices that should be shared. These were the voices that, you know, should be heard. So even in school, I felt voiceless. I was often reminded that I was an immigrant. I was a foreigner. And I felt like the other. One of my early experiences in elementary school was, I remember going into class one day and my teacher telling me, oh, today you're not gonna be in class. We're actually gonna have you go to a separate room. I remember feeling puzzled, like what classroom am I going to instead today? And I later found out that, you know, she wanted to put me in this program called ESL. So this was English as a second language. And I remember being a little kid and not understanding, like, why am I being put into this program? I can speak English just fine. I can understand it just fine. And it was basically her telling me that she didn't believe that, you know, I was able to communicate this language. And she had the perception that, you know, we were immigrants who didn't really fit into this culture of the classroom. And she wanted to make sure that I assimilated more to the culture. So now I want to ask you guys, why is it important to speak your truth? Why is it important to tell your story? One, representation matters. Your voice is a catalyst for someone out there who looks like you, who sounds like you, and who experiences the same things as you. I think for a large part of my life growing up, I wasn't really interested in a lot of the stories that I saw is because I was disinterested because I couldn't relate. I couldn't identify with a lot of the things that were being fed to me. I think it wasn't until I was in college and I was introduced to this novel called America's in the Heart by Carlos Bulosan. I remember reading that piece of literature, and I think I was probably 75% done with the book, and I was sitting there in my college dorm room reading this book, and I was crying. For the first time, I saw myself and I saw my family in these stories. And it was like opening Pandora's box. You know, it was mind-blowing to me to think that this is probably what my white counterparts felt like growing up, you know, seeing themselves represented in these stories. For the first time, I didn't feel like, you know, I was invisible, and I felt like I kind of had a place and a purpose in the place that I was in. And ultimately, I believe that life would have been a whole lot easier, you know, if I felt represented growing up. So fast forward several years, I'm taking more Asian American studies courses. I'm taking Filipino history class. I even get a tattoo of the Filipino flag on my wrist, and I feel super woke now, right? I feel super woke. I thought, okay, I'm finally forming an identity for myself. I know who I am. I know how I fit in society. Nope. This point in my life, I was already a performing artist. I was traveling to different cities in the U.S., speaking and performing. In one particular event, I was asked to do a keynote speech and a talk at in Washington, D.C. And I remember I was preparing for that talk. I remember it vividly in my head. And I honestly felt like I completely aced that talk. I felt really good about it. I was like on the plane back home to Oakland, and I was just, you know, super hyped about how the conference went. It was one of those moments where you're like, Alexa, play Beyonce's Feeling Myself. And I just felt really good about it until I remember we were about to land in the plane, and this gentleman next to me, this white gentleman, he turns to me and he says, oh, is it your first time here in the Bay Area? And I'm like, no, I grew up here. And then he says, no, really, where are you really from? Then I say, really, I'm really from the Bay Area. Then he continues to interrogate me, and he says, and, you know, it's mixed in with a little laugh, and he says, really, 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 where are you really from? So now I'm at this point where I feel like I have two options, okay? So my first option, A, I can easily go Manny Pacquiao on him and, like, cross him with, like, an uppercut or something and, like, really show him I'm really from the Bay Area. You about to see what the Bay Area is really from. Or I can B, which I ultimately do, is I turn to him and I say, Filipino. Then he responds, oh, I've dated a Filipina before. And I just remember slowly sinking into my seat. I honestly don't even remember the rest of the sentences that came out of his mouth. I just sat there, and I just remembered feeling like I was 5 years old again and not knowing who I was, and again, questioning my identity, and this time also questioning how other people perceived me. And I realized that what I saw in the mirror and how I viewed myself was not necessarily how others viewed me. So how come he didn't believe me that I was from here? What does it mean to be from a place? Did he suggest that my history wasn't here long enough? Is that why he thought that I wasn't from here? Or did his interrogation imply that I didn't look like I was from here? I just remember going home in disbelief again, you know, this time in my 20s, feeling like I'm still questioned about how I fit here in America. The very same questions that I grappled with in my head back when I was 5 years old. And this was a moment that I realized that I had the tools to use my voice, but not, I was not advocating for myself. I was still apologetic about who I was. And the person that I saw in the mirror still reflected what other people wanted to see me as. A, I didn't feel like I owned my story. And I felt like I still had to appease to people that weren't necessarily my audience. And B, at this point, I was still embarrassed about my accent. I don't know about you guys, but like for me growing up as a Filipino American, I remember there's been multiple times where my mom would slur her speech and I'd be the first one to correct her, like, no, you pronounce it this way. And then I felt like so heroic, like, yeah, I told you, mom. And now that I think about it, was I really helping her? Or was I just, you know, conforming to what people thought that we had to do to assimilate here? Was I doing it to, you know, to more so for my my insecurities, myself? And I think that's what I was putting onto my mother at the same time. I failed to realize that, you know, removing your accent is essentially erasure of identity and your voice. I had a story to tell and a voice, but I didn't know who my audience was and why I did what I do. So for those of you who don't know who I am, I probably should have said this in the beginning. I'm a rapper and spoken word artist from the Bay Area, California. And fast forward to 2016, I was tasked with to create an album, my first debut album. And I remember thinking, like, what do I even begin to write about? How can I create a full body of work when, what do I even put on paper? What do I put in this music? And the first thing that felt natural to me was to talk about my experiences, my family's experiences. I think that, you know, after creating that project, it was important to me to chronicle their stories because these are stories that often aren't heard, often aren't told. And it's made me realize after creating that project that our voice is the power to influence people. And that was the moment where I felt like I finally had a clear sense of direction. I spoke my truth and found my voice through sharing my identity. And then at the same time, I also regained my identity through finding my voice. One of the latest songs or videos that came out of my project was this song and video about empowering Filipino women. And I remember when we were in the midst of creating that music video, we put out a call to invite as many Pinays to come out. And we had over 150 show up. And mind you, this was 11 o'clock in the morning. Like, on Filipino time, that is surprising. That's a feat right there. But once the video came out and the responses that we received from it, it was just, I think, an affirmation and a reminder to me that, you know, we need to have, you know, representations of ourselves because it's powerful. I had so many people tell me that, you know, for the first time they saw not only themselves, but they saw their little sisters finally on a screen. And I think it's so powerful when you feel like you have a sense of belonging, when you feel like you have a knowledge of self, that's when you can truly feel confident and you can truly be unapologetic about who you are. Because your story is your voice. Your story, your experiences, even your accent is your voice. Every person has an important story to tell. You know, these stories are, I'm not saying that my story as a Filipino American encompasses every single experience out there. I know it's just a droplet in such a vast amount of experiences. And there's so many nuances that comes with the immigration experience. But I just want to hope that with the work that I do, that it'll inspire other people to share their stories as well. Because if other people share their stories, you know, that we can create a ripple effect from it. Maybe that'll inspire someone else to feel like, you know, they were seen and they want to share their stories as well. So I want to make a clear distinction, by the way, that when I say to use your voice, I don't mean it in the literal sense. I'm saying to tell your truth in whatever platform that you choose to decide you choose to use it in, is to be unapologetic in whatever platform or medium you use to share your story. And now, I want to give you a glimpse of how I've been sharing my story. It wasn't me. And I made up my mind to define check. They teach me to erase the brown. Subconsciously, I lose my crown till I don't even recognize the person that's inside me now. We came from the slums once, now living the humdrum. It's just the green funds, we never could keep one. My mama on 9-5, then switched to an 8-1. An immigrant family losing their names and effacing the place that we came from. These institutions working, the devil prove he lurking. They shoot us down, but first when we play the part in curtains. Open up till we prefer them, till we don't know we hurting. Till we become a version, a selfless last is first. So how can I breathe in this land of free? People ain't free when the freedom ain't free. I look in the mirror, they know that I see is a version of me that they want me to be. All of these lies they adapted to see. I'll never be what they want me to be. The devil's at work, can he looking like me? Can you tell me my worth and I pay you the fee? Till I fall on my knees and I feel in defeat. Give me your reason, the image they feed. Till the flows that I speak is me part of the sea. Part of my speech and the acts that I speak. I whiten my skin cause it's all that I see. No image of me represented to be. Myself, so I'm looking for ways I could be. Exactly like people they teach me to be. Toronto, you guys still good? Can we play the next track? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. 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 I wrote this album cause I want my life to change. Tired of being shortchanged, I'm trying to remain sane. Hopped off the plane, didn't stop all the pain. My father's still in debt and we've been struggling to pay. For a bedroom up on Meekland Ave, reaching for just meat and half. Hands tied against the odds, how the hell you even that? The people from the slums once, now living the humdrum. Mama from the barrio, so we dreaming we can stunt once. Mama, I know it's gonna be five wherever we go. Cause we know, your race is gonna dream and be a hero. What's an ego to an eagle? I free flow when I speak though. My pipe dreams throw people, my skin's so Filipino. But oftentimes my pride inside is fighting high tides. The day we broke the ocean was the day you learned to no stop. Closed eyes, fingerprint ink with the most dye. Those times mama never blinked, saved the oath twice. I said mama we gon' make it there someday. I said mama we gon' make it there someday. I said mama we gon' make it there someday. I said mama we gon' make it there someday. I said mama we gon' make it here someday. I said mama we gon' make it here someday. I said mama we gon' make it here someday. I said mama we gon' make it here. What's a freestyle to me? I've been doing this as a 6-year-old, thinking on my own 2 feet. Survival, pick and go, pick a roll. You can be the swimmer or a sunken soul. I was a 6-year-old without a father figure. Roll no silver spoons or dinner rolls. Will you fold or will you go? Pretend to sing like Figaro. My people still invisible. When you the spitting image of a person that you hate. Makes sense of spitting images of a tongue that never breaks. Nirvana never waits. I was a pawn of bitter fate. The spawn from inner hate. I never wanted to be great. I study my mother, wonder how she holds his family. That minimum salary stretch as much as it can be. Stress but keeps the shit from me. I'm just trying to fit and see a grave without acceptance. I can validate my sanity. I wrestle with affirmations, settle for masking faces. After all, the stolen lands are always greener places. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here. At school, reduced lunches when my mama skipped her lunchtime. 9-5, minimum wage, she at the bus line. Here I am, filling the page, waiting to brush rhymes. Till I'm nearing the day, I'm getting cosigned. Snare rolls and punchlines, the pay rolls and punch time. Take shows like crunch time, brave those like frontline. My life on these lines, cause we never had lifelines. So these days, I'm scared of what might go through my mind. Flow like Rizal and I'm rotten like Hagedorn. Mixed with Don Mambalona, watch as the page mourns. See my name, it tastes foreign. Time to make your face form. ways you never made war from another place. Thorns couldn't break away. You rhyme just to break away from being center stage. From off the page, or will I fade away? Never been the type to say, scared of what I have to face. All I ever knew was being me, so all I ever need to say is, I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it there someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. I said, mama, we gon' make it here someday. Thank you so much, Toronto.